tearing up the instruction manual, losing some of our best sources of ideas, and literally chucking 3.5 billion years of R&D overboard. That's not something to be complacent about. That is suicidal.
It really is the art of understanding how over millions of years, the laws of physics have created a framework within which chemistry and biology operates, with the minimum of resources and the minimum of energy.
Nature is the best engineer out there because it's amazingly complicated and amazingly functional. But we need engineers to take it from biology to the next level.
Nature's design brilliance is being destroyed at a species extinction rate 1,000 times higher than is normal in the Earth's evolutionary history. The very species we are eradicating may well contain blueprints for the profit and benefit of us all. Biomimicry, the science of understanding nature's unequaled efficiency and the art of turning that sophistication into technology useful for humankind, is just taking off. Thousands of scientists around the world are working to unlock nature's technologies. This week's Nature Inc. assesses biomimicry, where nature meets high tech. The 45 million year old design of a fly's eye, preserved in amber, makes all the difference to solar cell efficiency.
It's 45 million years old. It has a structure on its eye, on the surface of its eye, that is not a reflector of light, but an anti-reflector. Indeed, we can make this in a plastic and attach it to the surface of solar cells and allow all the light to go through. That way we gather an extra 10% of the energy that is available to the solar cells.
As long as there's been design, there's been inspiration from nature. Building, flying, even fusion power. Some subtle, some obvious. Mercedes-Benz, wanting to emulate nature, took the stubby boxfish as an ideal aerodynamic and practical shape and morphed the form into a real concept car. And by taking more cues from nature to make the car lighter, the result is a fuel consumption of 4.3 kilometers per litre and, according to Mercedes, one of the most aerodynamic cars in the world. The electron microscope has made it possible to see nature's secrets with ever greater detail. Wilhelm Bartlott has spent years understanding how the lotus leaf seemingly defies physics.
Isn't it wonderful? It's really a pleasure for a scientist.
Millions of years of evolution on, we'll come to the most spectacular.
This is a leaf of the sacred lotus, an old symbol of purity.
It's like a shield of mercury, but it's not mercury, it's an air film which coats the leaf. So I could say the leaf is not underwater, and it becomes obvious, I take it out completely dry. The trick behind it is the architecture, structures which are the cells superimposed by nanostructures. So the adhesion is completely reduced and it stays dry. Think of optication. I mean, one shouldn't say it in public. Think of a toilet in an airplane. We take a glue, a commercial glue. I mean, it's unbelievable.
The most successful commercial application of lotus surfaces are facade paints, exactly the same way as the lotus leaf.
Applications, ship hulls, air retaining ship hulls. In the first model boats, almost a small ship we used, we had a friction reduction of up to 10%. So imagine on a global scale, think of container ships, oil tankers, and so on and so forth.
It takes real leaps of imagination to understand the many functions that are always built into natural structures.
When you start looking at in an electric microscope, you see all sorts of exciting structures. You really want to know what they do. So you have to be open, I think, to go into different directions. So here in this case, we're certainly now working on water repellency in butterfly scales from a subject of optics. Now, a designer in a company would never go from optics into water repellency. And I think that's where biomimetics does have some good potential.
It took nature millions of years to evolve butterfly iridescence and 12 years for fabric company Teijing in Japan to understand how it works well enough to put their iridescent fabrics into production.
It is very difficult technology. Theory is very easy, but actually it's very difficult.
The same natural splashes of colour led another company, Qualcomm, to produce brighter screen technology. By using the way butterfly wings reflect light, they've made brighter displays that use very little energy.
It took a lot of convincing of my wife to get me to actually join, because this is all we had to look at. Pretty big leap to imagine these set of demonstrators into a final product.
So natural systems provide us with solutions. But as usually, solutions are packaged solutions. You can't substitute as one with the other. So the pitfall is that too much of our thinking today in business is core business based on core competence. We have one knowledge and we have one market. So there is a need to rethink the system. So if we're prepared, and I think thanks to the crisis, we are prepared to rethink the business model.
Officially, wait for this door to open. High tech. If you look at this, on the surface, is actually doing all these amazing movements that we're seeing. What we're trying to do is to create responsive, smart materials. And we're really interested in making them at will, design them with changeable properties so that they would have a controlled optical performance. Phil is telling me that results that we just obtained, very new results, we're getting them by luck. What I may say, that most of the things, most interesting things, are done by luck.
Whether creating synthetic opals or smart sensing materials by luck, Joanna Eisenberg loves life in the lab, but it's nature that really gets her going.
We'll find it. These organisms do not have eyes in the definition of higher organisms. They have something that is similar to compound eye of a fly. But it's a different eye. It's an eye composed of inorganic materials. So we won't use calcite as, for example, brittle star would use. We would use a better material that we know would create better lenses. But we will use design principles from a brittle star. So nature makes it, I hope you see the amazing regularity of this structure. Almost no mistakes in this chessboard structure that nature creates. So can we then design, engineer materials of this kind of complexity from a simple material like glass? This is in fact a glass house of the deep. There is always a pair of shrimp living inside that house. So it is, even nature is used as architecture. We are potentially going to use these design principles with steel, not with glass as nature does it. But we would still improve the design and create better structures by learning from nature.
Nature never wastes material, only ever using the absolute minimum, which means for us, the most effective design.
In nature, material is expensive and design is cheap, and that's something that's going to become increasingly relevant this century because we're facing more and more resource shortages, so there's a very good case for actually looking at some of the remarkable efficiencies within nature. What you're looking at there is actually the backdrop to an outdoor amphitheater, but it's also a zero carbon desalination plant. Idea really starts with this beetle called the Namibian fog basking beetle, which I think is just one of the most amazing examples of biomimicry there is, actually. It's so wonderfully ingenious. This is a creature that's evolved a way of creating its own fresh water in a desert.
The beetle climbs to the top of a dune, performs a handstand, and miraculously seems to collect the water, which is in the form of tiny droplets moving in a fast horizontal wind. You might be able to see some faint bumps and grooves or ridges on this back. Well, those are covered in a microstructure that is also additionally covered in wax. That acts as a super hydrophobic structure, just like the lotus leaf structure. However, when we make this, we don't need to copy that precisely.
The Sahara Forest Project is really based on these ideas. And actually, this produces far more than just water. It's a model for how we could create abundant fresh water in some of the most water-stressed parts of the planet, zero-carbon food, renewable energy, and revegetating areas of desert.
Perhaps we will never copy something precisely. We will begin to, well, first of all, we work out what's there in nature. Then we have to think how we can make it. Then we have to think how we can make it on a commercial scale.